Here.
Thank you.
Who operated the candy, the camera last time? Who? You two, all right, so I give you guys candy, I've just given candy last time for operating. Well, you can just go in front of the camera, it's fine. The videos are available on YouTube, links to the videos are on the class webpage. The class webpage is still under construction. What I did was simply copy the old one to the new one and edit it, but I haven't really finished editing it. So as I said to you before, it's important to go to the problem section. And the reason I do the videos is so that students can look and see what's something they might have missed, but also so that if you're sick someday, instead of coming to class and infecting everybody else, you know, stay home, get well, watch the video. So that's the theory of it. Also, maybe people, you know, the internet in some unknown place who want to learn physical mathematics, in which case they can watch the videos too. All right, let me just say a little more about photons. We had that demo last time. First of all, in general, in quantum mechanics, if you have a two-dimensional space, then you might have two basis vectors. You can have arbitrary complex numbers, and of course, normally we have we normalize the states. So C1 squared plus C2 squared should equal 1. One basis for the states of a single photon of a given momentum k is the positive helicity state and the negative helicity state. These have angular momentum h bar in the direction of motion, in this case, opposite the direction of motion in that case. The general state is C1 k plus C2 k minus, where again, if you normalize it, C1 squared plus C2 squared is 1. And this general state is what's called elliptical polarization. If C1 or C2 is 0, then what we have is states of pure helicity. That is to say, we have either this state or that state. And then the other possibility is linear polarization. And linear polarization is when C1 equals C2. And in that case, what one can say is that K, I'll just write it as L for linear, so it's e to the I theta over root 2 K plus e to the I V over root 2 K minus. And as you know in quantum mechanics, the overall phase of a state doesn't matter, so you can effectively rewrite this as e to the I theta minus V over 2 root 2 K plus e to the I V minus theta over 2 root 2 K minus. So that's a general state of linear polarization. And what you notice here is that this phase is the complex conjugate of that phase. So in fact, what I should have called these is C plus and C minus. And then we have C minus and C plus complex conjugate. Okay. Any questions? All right, now where exactly were we? Well, it's like all I had to do was look at the tail end of the video to find out where we were. But the tail end of the video was the demo. What was just before the demo?
We were going to start vectors.
I'm sorry, say it again.
We were going to start vectors. We ended with matrices and we were going to start 1.4.
Okay, so you're saying I was just about to start the section on vectors.
Yeah, section 1.4.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's great. Thank you. Well, as I said in the problem session yesterday, we use the word vector in two senses, as the abstract vector and as a vector in a particular basis. And when we have it a vector in a particular basis, a column vector, row vector, an integral, whatever, of so many complex numbers. Abstractly, vectors are simply things that that can be multiplied. So vectors can be multiplied by complex numbers and added together. And of course that was implicit in all these things that I did here. Here's a vector multiplied by a complex number, another vector multiplied by a complex number, add them together. So if U and V are two vectors, then W equals XU plus YV is another vector. And we normally talk of a vector space. That's the space that we're interested in, and it's a set of vectors that are all linear combinations of whatever the basis vectors are in other words, if we just start with U and V and we take arbitrary multiples, real X and Y, we have one vector space. Arbitrary multiples, complex X and Y, we have another vector space. If we have yet more vectors and take multiples of them, then we get a different vector space. Now, an important concept which you probably already learned is a basis for a vector space. And so it's a set of vectors BK such that any vector S, any vector in the space, the vector space can be written as C1 B1 plus C2 B2 plus dot 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 plus CN BN. So that's, oh, I see now I'm departing from the notation of the text slightly. These, if we speak mathematically, then these C's are elements, are numbers, and so they're in some field of numbers. But for practical purposes in physics departments, these things are real numbers or complex numbers, in fact. And by the way, when I say a complex number, I'm including the possibility that the number could be real or purely imaginary. Okay. These things are called the components. And in the basis. And in fact, one could, in fact, it's hard, I don't know of a way of making, of being really pure with regard to notation. Because if this is the abstract vector, it's natural to write it this way. In other words, to say, well, this is the column vector that represents this vector. But it's hard not to say that you use the same symbol U for both of them. I don't know, maybe there's a better notation, but I trust that your minds are young and flexible and you cope with this slight ambiguity here. Now, what's really nice is if the vectors are orthonormal. And in other words, if the inner product of these vectors is, I meant to write KL, but I got it backwards. And by inner product, well, sometimes in direct notation it can be written this way. If these are just n-dimensional complex vectors, then it might be written this way. Those are different ways of writing the vector. Here, when I'm writing it this way, what I mean is the column vector or row vector that represents the vector in a particular basis. And in fact, if these vectors are orthonormal, then their components can be written as bi is the inner product of bi with the vector u. And that's because this would be bi sum, in this case, sum ck bk. On the other hand, this inner product is delta ik, so this is a sum ck delta ik, which is c sub I. Well, all right, I meant c sub I. When I have my left hand up and I'm following the notes, you can be pretty sure that what I'm writing is correct. When the left hand goes down and I'm writing things freely without looking at my notes, they're liable to be typos, so you have to be careful. And students who point out mistakes or typos get candy also. So there were very few questions in the first class, in the problem session, and so far in this class, very few questions. I think there's something wrong with the American educational system that it discourages questions. So I try to fix that by throwing candy to students who ask questions. And I can just urge you to ask questions. The question benefits you because you get an answer to the question if something is puzzling you. But secondly, it also clears things up for five or six other people in the class who have exactly the same question or a very similar question. So do ask questions. And by the way, asking a question doesn't mean you're stupid. When our department actually had funding before the financial crisis and the Republican takeover of the House of Representatives, we were able occasionally to invite sort of celebrity physicists like C.N. Yang, who won the Nobel Prize for discovering parity shared with Lee. And he gave a couple of talks. He also sat in on one of our talks. Sat in the first row, in the middle, must have asked 10 or 12 questions. So asking questions isn't a sign of stupidity. C.N. Yang is one of the smartest people who ever lived. In fact, he's still alive. Okay, so. So let's see. All right, there are many other examples here. I would urge you simply to read the examples in the text. If I do every example in class, we're going to spend too much time on each chapter. So I'm going to essentially skip most of these examples. But because some of them are a little unusual, I'll just mention an example of a vector is partial derivative. The partial derivative with respect to x, partial derivative with respect to y, you can multiply them by complex numbers, you can add them together, and you get some new
differential operator, which I don't know, it's just called DAB. Okay. So these, so partial derivatives are vectors. It's an example of a vector. Functions are vectors. And if you have a bunch of functions, multiply them by complex numbers, add them together, you get a new function. And so the functions themselves can be thought of as vectors. Okay? And they form a vector space of functions. Okay. And then, of course, these states of the photon are functions. Okay, linear operators. Well, a linear operator, and I'll try to follow the notes, A on BV plus CW, this gives us A, no, sorry, B times A of V plus C times A of W. Okay, and in fact, this, I'm writing it this way, is the action of A on the linear operator on the vector B. We almost always write this as just A, B, A, B plus C, C, W. Okay, so that's what a linear operator is. And if we have a basis vector or a set of basis vectors that for a vector space S, then A on BI is going to be A1I B1 plus A2I B2. So an arbitrary linear operator will turn this into, if this is an n-dimensional space, ANI BN. So the linear operator will map each basis vector into a linear combination of basis vectors. You may find the order here puzzling. Well, that's because I'm starting out using traditional notation. When we use Dirac notation, the ordering will make sense. So this is sort of counterintuitive ordering. It's just a defect of the normal way of the normal notation. So what is the matrix that represents this linear operator in this basis? Well, if V is some vector, V1, B1 plus V2, B2 plus dot 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 plus Bn, Bn, suppose that would be an arbitrary vector in the vector space S, then A on V would be, I guess I can write this as a sum Vk A on Bk, and on the other hand, A on Bk, then this would be a sum Vk, notice the left arm is down, so you've got to watch out now. This would be a sum, according to this formula, it would be A that's K. So AK I. So now we're summing over K and I. And I forgot the extra thing, BI. I should have just followed the notes. A on B. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so what is the matrix that represents it? It's effectively this sum here, and so yeah, I've changed the notation string much. I really should have just.
Well, we can use the simply form the inner product of, say, DL with AV here, and that would pull out, what would it do? It would pull out the Lth one, so that would be VK AKL. And so that's the KL, this is effectively AKL. Oh Lord, let me just follow the notes. I think I'm ad-libbing here, and there's so much notation that I'm screwing everything up. So, AV is A on a sum, and in the last few days I've changed some of the notation, and so I've got a mixture of notation here in the notes. So this is a sum, UI, A, EI. This is then a sum, UI, a sum, AKI, DK. And so we can rewrite it as a sum K, sum I, AKI, UI, DK. And so what we can say is that the component U prime K of V prime equal to AV is U prime K is AK1 U1 plus AK2 U2. In other words, it's this thing here plus AKN, well, dots, AKN UN. Or U prime K is a sum on I up to N of AKI UI. I'm going to just religiously follow the notes if I can make myself do it. Any questions? This the standard notation is confusing, and that's why the direct notation is so much better. So the column vector that represents the vector v prime is simply v prime equals to AV. In other words, U prime equals AV. This is just in this equation in matrix notation is that. Now, a given linear operator is unique, but the matrix that represents it depends upon the basis. So if we change from the VK basis to the V prime basis, V prime I say, and we say B prime I is a sum, UKI, BK, and this is K equals 1 to N, let us say, then this is a square N by N matrix, and if we do change from one basis to another, it would be really stupid to use a matrix that didn't have an inverse, because we want to be able to get back to the original basis. And consequently, what we can say is that there's an inverse matrix, U inverse KI, and in fact, the sum on K of UKI inverse P prime K is a sum on K, U inverse KI, and now what's B prime? Well, B prime is this, and in this case, it's the sum ULK BL. And now we have U inverse U, and so this is going to be the sum delta IL BL, and so that's BI. So, BI is equal to that. And so then A on B prime I is the sum UKI ABK. That's this original. Where did I write that down?
Did I write that down?
B prime. Yeah, that's this equation. Which this equation multiplied by A gives us this. And so that's a sum EKI AJK J, because we've figured out what A is in the original basis, how it acts. It acts like this on the basis vectors. And on the other hand, BJ is then a sum U K I A J K, and now this is U inverse L J B prime L. So what that says, that in the B prime basis, the matrix A is represented by this thing. So and so we would say that A prime L I is a sum J K goes 1 to N of U inverse L J A J K U K I I have a B L here. I don't think we want a B L there. That's a typo. Or in matrix notation, A prime is U inverse A U. So in other words, when we change where U is this square matrix. So in if you change a basis, change from one basis to another, the matrix that represents a linear operator changes by a similarity transformation. This is called a similarity transformation. Similarity transformation. Typically, when we change a basis in quantum mechanics, we use a unitary matrix. And then U inverse is equal to U adjoint. And in that case, A prime Li is a sum on J and K of ULJ AJK U adjoint KI. And of course, the adjoint of a matrix is the transpose of its complex conjugate. So this is a sum on JK, ULJ, AJK, U complex conjugate IK. So the utility of using the adjoint is that you can have this nice pattern of indices, whereas when you go to, when you turn that into transpose complex conjugate, you get screw up.
Yeah. I had a question regarding the adjoint. It's the adjoint is the conjugate of the transpose. Of a matrix. Yeah. Would it be the same if you do the conjugate of the matrix first and then do the transpose? Would it be?
Oh yeah. No problem at all. Yeah, they're totally independent things. So basically, you complex conjugate every element in the matrix and then transpose it, or you transpose it and then complex conjugate it. It's exactly the same. And now, when this matrix form becomes A prime equals U adjoint AU. Oh, I see, I forgot to change. Okay, there's a typo here. If we're taking this equation and going to the case where U is unitary, then what we've got is U adjoint here and no U there, and no U there. And so if we complex conjugate it, then it's JL, and this is still KL. So, sorry, I was editing this to improve its, to improve it, and of course I forgot to change one of the equations. Any other questions? All right, now there's an example there on change of basis. I recommend that you work through it, but I think I'm going to have to skip it in class because otherwise we just won't have time. So, but examples by their nature are things that you can work through on your own. All right, the next topic is something that we have used implicitly in the last couple, in today and on Tuesday, and it's the idea of an inner product. So there are inner products and outer products. Now, most of the inner products that we use as physicists are what are called positive definite inner products. So let me start out with that one first. So a positive definite inner product. This is one that obeys certain rules. First of all, an inner product of vectors can be written like this, and pretty soon we'll write it in Dirac notation like that. So it associates with every ordered pair of vectors a number. So it's a map from two vectors into, let us say, the complex numbers in general. And what's the nature of that? In fact, that the thing that the pair goes into is the inner product, and that's a complex number. Now, what kind of complex numbers are they? Well, they have to satisfy this, that if, when you interchange the order, the inner product changes by complex conjugation. That's the first thing. Secondly, it's linear in the first element. So z g plus w h is equal to z f g plus w f h. That's w. By the way, we have a colloquium tomorrow about gravitational waves. You should go to all the colloquia. Now, if you're in a colloquium and the colloquium has gotten so technical you don't understand a damn thing, just leave. And that serves a purpose. It tells the speaker that he's gotten too technical. Okay. So, but you should go to the colloquia, and they will inform you of what's interesting in current research. We try to kind of cover a lot of the physics and astronomy in these colloquia. You should go 3:30 over there at Dane Smith Hall. You have to cross Lomas carefully, climb the hill, and anyway, there's coffee and some sort of donuts or bagels or something. I hope you all go with it. All right, so it has a Hermitian structure. That's what we call this. It's linear in the second element, and it's positive definite. That means that the inner product of any vector with itself is either zero or a positive number, and if it's zero, then the vector f is zero. So that's the nature of a positive definite inner product. It has its Hermitian, linear in the second element, and All the an inner product of a vector with itself is positive or zero, and if it's zero, and only the zero vector has a zero inner product with itself. So that's the standard kind, and almost always in physics, that's what we're using. By the way, these two rules imply that the inner product is anti-linear in the first element. So let me just, and this is an exercise. So ZG plus WHF is Z star GF plus W star what does that do here? W star HF. Okay, so you can, so exercise 111 is to show that. So the positive definite inner product then is Hermitian. It's linear in the second, antilinear in the first. The inner product of a vector with itself is positive, except for the zero vector, in which case it's zero. All right. Any questions? There's a slightly different one called a Schwarz inner product. And a Schwarz inner product obeys the first two rules, but it has a slightly weaker second rule. The second rule is simply FF is greater than or equal to zero. And another exercise, if you do another exercise, you can show that if you have this one plus this one and this, but not this part, you have something very close to it. Namely, that if FF is zero, then GF is zero for all G in the vector space. Okay, so it's almost, so in other words, it's almost positive definite. It's just that if FF could be zero, but if it is zero, it's orthogonal to every vector in the vector space. Okay, so it's almost positive definite. Now then, there's a third kind of inner product. This is called these are the indefinite inner products. And these are the ones that that occur in special and general relativity. You have a four vector. The inner product of a four vector with itself, it's a Minkowski inner product. If it's positive, we say it's space-like. If it's negative, it's time-like. In other words, we have a vector like this, xt. So the inner product of xt with xt is, of course, x squared minus t squared, and I've often, all right, I'll put a c in there. So if this is positive, it's space-like, negative, it's time-like, and zero, it's null, or like-like. So we have here an indefinite metric. And an indefinite metric satisfies the first two rules. It satisfies a third rule, namely non-degenerate. Mathematicians love the word degenerate and also non-degenerate. I don't know quite why. Anyway, what this means is that if FG is zero, if FG is zero for all F in V, then G is zero. So a vector that's orthogonal to all the other vectors has to be zero. And you can see that that works for what's called the Minkowski interval product. All right, so as long as the inner product is not indefinite, we can define the norm of a vector as the square root of the inner product of a vector with itself. And the distance between two vectors is the square root of, well, that's the distance between two vectors. So it's f minus p, comma f minus g square root. So that's the distance. That works for positive definite Schwarz inner products and positive definite and Schwarz. Doesn't work for indefinite. All right, well, examples, of course, are Euclidean space and n dimensions. There, the inner product is just x dot y, for example, is a sum xi, yi. If you have an n-dimensional complex space, then z dot, or if you want, z comma w is a sum zi star, wi, I equals 1 to n, however many dimension is. So these are both positive definite inner products. And even though this is an example, I'm going to mention what it is. Suppose we have n by n matrices. And in fact, they don't even need to be n by n. It's easier if they're n by n. Let's just say they are n by n for simplicity. The inner product is the trace of a dagger b. And you can see that this is a positive inner product because the inner product of a with a would be the trace of a dagger a. And in terms of a complete set of states, that's a sum on n and m, a, n, m, abscissary squared, actually. And so that's obviously positive unless the matrix A is identically zero. This is a positive definite inner product. This is an important inner product to think about. Okay, so a vector space with a positive definite inner product, the nice kind, and in physics, it's almost always a positive definite inner product that we deal with, certainly in quantum mechanics. And that's called an inner product space, a metric space, a pre-Hilbert space. Okay. Now, let me just mention, while I get a drink of water here, a notion from calculus is one about convergence, the convergence of a sequence. So if you have a sequence of vectors, f1, f2, dot, 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 fn, this is called a Cauchy sequence or a Cauchy sequence. If for every epsilon greater than zero, there exists an integer n of epsilon such that the norm of the difference of the two vectors is less than epsilon if n and m are both greater than capital N of epsilon. So if you go far enough out in the sequence, you can make the norm the difference between them, the distance between any two vectors arbitrarily small. Now, of course, a sequence of vectors converges to a vector f if this is less than epsilon as long as n is greater than some n of epsilon. So that's standard convergence. That's when a sequence of vectors converges to a vector. Okay. Now, a vector space with an inner product is said to be complete if every Cauchy sequence converges to a vector in the vector space. And a Hilbert space is a complete inner product space. So a Hilbert space. Quantum mechanics books are constantly mentioning Hilbert spaces, and you know, I've never seen the term defined in a quantum mechanics book. But anyway, it is a complete inner product space. And in fact, it's probably has to be a positive definite inner product space. Certainly, if it is positive definite, that's good enough. And the example I gave in the beginning of the class of just a two-dimensional space of polarization vectors for a photon, that's the Hilbert space. On the other hand, an infinite dimensional complete inner product space is the space of all square integrable functions, also with the Hilbert space. And that's why in quantum mechanics, the example in so many systems is we have wave functions psi n of x such that this thing is squared dx, d cubed x integrated is some finite number. In fact, we often normalize it to 1. So these are square integrable functions. They form a Hilbert space. And the inner product in that Hilbert space of two functions would be fg, if they're defined just on an interval, would be an integral from a to b dx, f star of x, g of x. So it's a very simple inner product. And the norm squared of the function f is just the integral dx, f of x, absolute value squared from a to b in this particular case. Okay, any questions? All right, the next topic is the Cauchy-Schwarz or Cauchy-Schwarz inner product or inequality. This is a very important inequality. It's that the inner product of a vector with itself times the inner product of some other vector with itself is always greater than the inner product of those two different vectors, absolute value squared. And this is true for any Schwarz inner product, and since every Schwarz inner product is also, since a positive definite inner product is a Schwarz inner product, it's certainly true for a positive definite inner product. Okay, so how do we prove this? What we do is we start out with this condition of positivity, namely f minus lambda g, f minus lambda g. This inner product with itself has to be non-negative, and it's going to be ff minus lambda star. Remember, it's anti-unitary in the first element, anti-linear in the first element. So this is, and this is greater than or equal to 0. All right. Now, the one fly in the ointment is, what if GG itself was 0? So if G GG equals zero, then what do we know? We know that because it's a Schwarz inner product or a positive definite inner product, that G is either zero itself or orthogonal to all other vectors. In that case, not only is GG zero, but FF is zero, and GF is zero, and FG is zero. So this thing is trivially satisfied if GG is zero, because both sides are zero. In fact, zero squared. So the thing is true. So trivially so, if GG is zero. If G, yes?
Would it be that both sides are zero, or would it just be that FF, it would just say the statement that FF has to be greater than or equal to zero? Like, why would FF be zero if G was zero?
Good question. Actually, you're right. Very smart. You get two candies. Yeah, he's right, actually, because if GG is zero, then this is zero, these two are zero, but FF need not be zero. But on the other hand, it's still satisfied because zero is on both sides. So let me give you the two candies, though. Yeah, actually, in the book, I don't go so far as to say that FF is zero. I just said that FG is zero. All right, so now let's consider the case where GG is non-zero. Well, if GG is non-zero, then what we can do is divide through by GG. And in that case, wait a second. Oh, right, let's rewrite this thing. So we can rewrite this equation as F minus GF over GG times G, F minus GF over GG times G. So in other words, we can rewrite this equation as the inner product of a vector with itself. And that certainly is non-negative. And in fact, what is it? Well, the first term is F with F, so that's FF. Then we have, let me write it out explicitly. We have minus F GF. Actually, it's FG. You see, we have this F with that G, so that's FG. And then we have GF over GG. So that was the F. Now we have G with F with a minus sign. Let me just make sure I've got everything. Oh. I think there's a typo here. I think one of these should. All right, now I'm confused. One of these, I think, should be FG. So let's see. This one, this F times that is FG and GF. And I think that's exactly what we need. But on the other hand, this one is GF twice. So I should have written it this way. So there's a typo there. Okay, so you can verify, I hope, that this is the same as that. And now this one into this is FG, GF, then finally it's plus, and now we've got, it was right the first time. What I forgot was that it's antilinear in the first. So this was GF. And, but the point is that when this comes out, what we get for this one is G with F with a minus sign, but GF turns into FG, which is the complex conjugate. So in other words, FG is GF complex conjugate. Okay, then the last term, I don't have room to write it there, so I'm going to write it here. The last term then is plus GF FG, and that's the complex conjugate of this. And then G squared over G squared squared, so it is simply over GG. Okay, so what does this give us? This cancels, one of these cancels. And this thing is greater than or equal to zero still. And so then, so the equation we have is FF minus FG GF over GG is greater than or equal to zero. Multiplying through by GG, we get FF GG minus FG GF is greater than or equal to zero. And that's just exactly this statement here, since this thing is that. And so this is the statement, FF GG is greater or equal to FG, that's the raised square. Okay. So that's the truth of the Schwarz inequality. And this is, of course, a very important and very general result because it applies to an arbitrary positive definite, an arbitrary space that has a positive definite or a Schwarz inner product. And so an example of this would be two complex n vectors. You only use bar for complex conjugate. U bar dot u, v bar dot v is greater than or equal to u bar dot v, absolute a squared. For, and this can be used to show that u plus v, the length of u plus the length of v, is greater than or equal to the length of u plus v. So there's a sort of triangle inequality. And then an example from the space of functions is a to b dx f of x squared times a to b dx g of x squared is greater than or equal to absolute value integral a to b f bar of x g of x dx absolute value squared. So that's another example of the Schwarz inequality. All right, any questions? You can, of course, ask questions just by shouting them out. You don't, while I'm lecturing, you don't need to wait for me to ask for questions. Okay, linear independence and linear dependence. This is an extremely general and consequently an extremely useful concept. I think I'm going to erase some of the boards so that we can have nice clear, something nice and clear to look at. So here, when I set a basis, obviously you don't want redundant vectors in your basis. Did somebody ask a question? No. All right, you don't want redundant vectors in your basis. And a linearly independent set of vectors is a set of vectors that's basically not redundant. And so let me first define what linear dependence is. And that's a redundant set of vectors. And what that means is that if you have n vectors that are linearly dependent, then you can find n complex numbers, some of which are not zero, such that a linear combination of those numbers times the vectors adds up to zero. So that's a linearly dependent, that's what a linearly dependent set is. So here I use this. This board was broken by one of the previous chairmen who chaired the department, and it was never properly fixed, so it's a lousy blank board. So if we have numbers such that C1, B1 plus C2, B2 plus CN, BN equals zero, sum CI not equal to zero, one or more, at least one of them has to be non-zero, then we say that these vectors are linearly dependent. So any three vectors, three non-zero vectors in a plane are linearly dependent. Any four non-zero vectors in three space, linearly dependent. And of course, linearly independent, a set of vectors is linearly independent if it's not linearly dependent. Mathematicians are nothing if not consistent. Okay, now, a set of vectors Vi is maximal in of linearly independent vectors is maximal in some space S if the addition of any extra vector to the set S, to the set Vi. So these guys are linearly independent. They're maximal in the vector space if you take any vector in S and form a new set Vi plus this vector U, and this is now linearly dependent. So a linearly independent set is maximal if you can't enlarge it and stay within the vector space. Okay. Now, if you have a maximal linearly independent set, then you can represent any vector in the space as a in terms of these basis vectors. That is to say, you can always write U equals C1 V1 plus C2 V2 plus CN VN. So the V's are maximal in the space S, U is any vector in the space S, and you can always do that. Now, why can you do that? Well, the reason you can do that is that if you add U to the set, then the set U, V1, V2, up to Vn is linearly dependent, so you can find coefficients that make the whole linear combination vanish, and not all of them are zero. Moreover, C0 can't be zero, because if C0 was zero, then some of these guys would have to be non-zero. This would disappear, and you'd have the V's linearly dependent. But we're assuming that the V's are linearly independent. Consequently, C0 is not zero, and so you can write U as minus 1 over C0 times C1 V1 plus Cn Vn. Okay. So what that shows then is if you have a maximal set of linearly independent vectors in a vector space, then it can represent, that set can represent, linear combinations of that set can represent any vector in the vector space. And so that forms, what we say then is that the VI span the space S, or equivalently they form a basis for the space S. Yeah?
I have a question then. When you define bases over there before...
When I define what? Bases?
Bases of the course. But you said where that the basis vectors are orthogonal.
That's not necessary.
I mean, because...
Yeah, I'm sorry, I shouldn't interrupt it.
My question is, because the basis then is a maximal linear independent set, right?
A basis is a maximal linearly independent set, yes.
Is that the same as saying that then the vectors that form a basis happen to be orthogonal?
No.
It's not the same
set. No, orthonormality is just a luxury. But it turns out that it's a luxury that's very nice to have, and because of computers, if you're dealing with a real problem, you can make any linearly independent set of vectors, you can make them orthonormal very easily with a computer. In fact, I'll show you we probably won't get to it today, but there's a standard way of taking any set of linearly independent vectors and making them orthonormal. The standard way is Gram-Schmidt. But you should keep in mind there are infinitely many ways of doing it. And Gram-Schmidt is just a way that occurs in textbooks. But there are infinitely many ways of doing it. Alright, so another way of saying it is to say that these vectors VI are complete. They form a complete set. So complete is the same thing as saying it spans, and that's the same thing as saying it's a maximal set of linearly independent vectors. Orthonormality, though, is something extra. You can make them orthonormal if you want, and okay. Now, suppose you have a vector space, and you have two maximal sets of linearly independent vectors, VI, and their animum, and now you have another set, Wj and their m of them. Well, n has to equal m. That's sort of intuitively true. I have an argument in the text, but I don't think I'm going to go through that argument because I'm still looking for a better argument. But so let's just say that The number of vectors in a maximal linearly independent set for a given vector space, that's a unique integer.
and you can't have two maximal sets with different numbers of integers, different numbers of vectors. Okay, here's the orthonormality. We actually will be able to do it. So this is, what's appealing about this is that it's so systematic. So we're starting out with vectors v1, vn, linearly independent. And we want to make new vectors u, such that ui, uj is delta ij. So these are orthonormal. Of course, if vectors are orthonormal, they have to be linearly independent. Okay, so the first thing we do is we just take u1 to be v1 divided by the square root of v1, v1. So now the norm of u1 is 1. What do we do for u2? We say u2 is... Oh, there's a typo. I'm going to use a funny notation here. Lowercase u2 is the unnormalized one. So u2 is v2 plus some complex number v12 times u1. Okay. Now, what we need is that u2 should be orthogonal to v1. Or let me write it the other way. V1 should be orthogonal to U2. Now V1, the inner product of V1 with U2 is V1 V2 plus C12 I really must follow the notes, because this stuff is too complicated to just read. Okay, so U2 is that. Now we want U2 to be orthogonal to U1. And so we have 0 is U1, U2, and this is U1, big U1, C12, U1, plus V2. We want that to be 0. This is 1, so this is C12 plus U1 V2. So what we do is we choose C12 to be minus U1 V2, minus the inner product of U1 with V2. Okay, so then U2 is V2 minus U1 V2 U1, and now big U2 is just with this U2 divided by the square root of its norm, U2 is U2. So now we have two that are orthogonal to each other and are normalized. The next one is we set U3 equal to V3 plus C13 U1 plus C23 U2. And now we have two constraints. 0 should be U1 with U3. We want U3 to be orthogonal to U1, and we want it to be orthogonal to U2. And now U1 with this, well, this is... this is U1, C12, 13, U1, plus C23, U2, plus V3. And now U1, U1 is unity. U1, U2 is 0. And so this is C13 plus U1, V3. This one is U2 on the same thing, right? Yeah, C13 U1 plus C23 U2 plus V3. And now
This term is zero, this term is C23, and the next term is U2 with V3. Okay, so we just said C13 equal to minus that, C23 equal to minus this, and we satisfied both of those. All right, so you just continue in this way, normalize each one, and you wind up with everything orthonormal. Normal. All right, I think we should stop at this point.
What's the name of this book?
It's called Gram-Schmidt, and the hard part is spelling Gram and Schmidt. The method's easier than the spelling. At least I think I googled it, and so that's the correct spelling, but I'm not sure. Anything else? Okay, you just asked a question though, right?
No, it was not a question.
Well, it's okay. It's okay. All right, so let's turn off the video and...